Well, it seems like parents are always being warned about the teenage years. And even if you're not there yet, it might pay to be prepared. We've got Darby Fox. She is the author of a book called Rethinking Your Teenager. Hi, Darby.
Hi, how are you?
I'm happy to have you here. I'm doing well. So I have to just start out with, you know, the beginning question. I'm sure that many of our viewers who are parents are asking this question. Why do our teenagers tend to make such questionable decisions at times? Can we just blame it all on hormones and people changing, or what is it?
So Elsa, that's a great question. Definitely hormones are at play because they're surging in a way they never have before, but we can't blame it all on hormones. And because they're going to have these surges of hormones for, you know, kind of ongoing for the rest of their lives, we want to know, okay, you have to still behave a certain way, even if this is happening. So for instance, I think a more important thing to keep in mind is teenagers are hardwired to look for gratification. So they kind of like ignore the risk. The neurotransmitters are saying, look for something new, look for something gratifying. And if we remember that, then we can say, all right, maybe it's not just the hormones. Maybe there's some other stuff we can do.
All right. So let's talk about that teen rebellion. Is that necessarily, or is that a necessary part of their development?
Yes and no. I mean, it is a necessary part because what we have to remember is biologically, a teenager is hardwired to start to be thinking, okay, I got to go out on the world and survive on my own. Mm-hmm. So I have to be able to do this on my own. And that's kind of where their brain, their hormones, their neurotransmitters, all of that is gearing them to be able to be self-sufficient. So they want to do it on their own. But the rebellion is, I think that parents get a little bit of afraid and then they try to control them. So One thing I want to offer for a better sort of more successful adolescent, you know, the sort of 13 to 19 year range, is to think more about giving them a little more control, but then also holding them accountable and responsible for what they do. Really important.
Got it. Okay. And so adolescent behavior, of course, it impacts teens' relationships with his or her parents a lot. Why does this happen, especially at this juncture?
Well, it goes to what I was just talking about. So they're hardwired to be sort of two things, looking for new and gratifying things. And they're also thinking, I got to do this on my own now. I'm getting older. I got to do this. So what parents can do better to connect and have that relationship is have real strong boundaries. Let your adolescent actually deal with a consequence if they come home late or if they fail a test. Don't rescue them. Don't call the teacher. Say, okay, you know what? I get it. You weren't prepared. What can we do now? You didn't come home on time. So you know what? Actually, you can't go out this weekend. And by the way, you got to pick your sister up at soccer practice. Whatever that may be, we really want to hold accountable consequences and then kind of turn it over to them. It's important to say the consequence is yours. Like, I love you to death, but you kind of chose not to come home on time.
Right.
Like, I'm sorry, but this is what happens when you don't do that. Because again, remember, we're modeling what happens as right. You become an adult, right? But we want to preview a little bit those consequences. Like, this is what could happen. Because in the moment, they don't really think about it. They're thinking what looks fun.
So tell us tips for getting teens to listen. This all sounds great, but how are they going to listen to this?
Ask them what they think. When we just tell them, this is what happened to me, or you better do this, they immediately shut off. You ask any teen about one sentence in, they're like, heard this before. So what you want to say is, well, what do you think? Yeah. What would be a fair consequence?
Yeah.
Or, you know, and a really great one is to say, what would you do if that were your kid, or what would you do to your sibling? They're interestingly pretty harsh on siblings. That's a pretty good, you know, sort of barometer.
Yeah, right. And I'm wondering, and this is sort of off script, but I always think about when my daughter's only 7, so she's not there yet. But
yeah,
when
I was going to say, you don't look old enough.
I know, it's common though. But when I think about my little cousins and my nieces, I always try to tell them, like, look, I remember being 16. And I also try to hold on to those memories of how I felt at that age of 14, 15, 16. Is that helpful, or does it come from just a perspective of they're like, well, you're old. That was a long time ago.
No, it's super helpful that you say that, but then make that connection. I know it's difficult. I know it's not always clear. And you know what? If you screw up, I'm still here.
Got it.
Like, okay. I'm here for you, but think about this. And then they're like, oh, she gets it. She's a cool aunt or
cool mom.
Yeah. And the cool mom means I'm here, but I'm going to hold you accountable and I'm going to love you no matter what, but that doesn't mean you always get your own way.
Exactly.
Really important. Doesn't mean the cool mom's like totally permissive.
I love your book, Rethinking Your Teenager. How do we get our hands on this book?
So you can get it at Amazon.com, most big bookstores, Oxford, or it's in Audible if you prefer books, Yes, please read it.
Perfect. All right, Darby Fox, thank you so much for being with us. Really appreciate it. And we'll be right back with more Midday Maryland right after this. Stay tuned. Yeah.